Right, okay, thank you. So for an operator talk, we'll now join us Martin Rune Pedersen, COO of Maersk Oil. Please take a seat, Martin. Okay, so reflections on the previous talk. There's an image problem, first and foremost. What can be done about it?
Well, am I on? Can you hear me? No? Hello?
Yeah, well, there's a microphone coming for us. Sorry about that.
No problem. Hello, can you hear me now? Yes, thanks. First and foremost, thanks for asking me to join. I was actually sitting there very eager to jump into the discussion because I think it was a great discussion on the panel and clearly something that motivated the audience. So I'm sure you saved all the tough questions for me. I do agree. I think we can certainly be much better at telling the story. And I think Thomas Damkjær's view of saying that the perception is a dirty industry. We are certainly not a dirty industry. Our platforms are actually quite neat and clean. And we can do much more. We are on social media. We are actually showing videos of all the big stuff that we do. And I think we have so much really that can attract also the young graduates. Where else can you join a company straight from university and get to work on projects that are multi-billion kroner projects as a young graduate engineer. Mm-hmm. I think the opportunities are fantastic.
So what else would you point to?
So I think we can talk much more about what the innovation, the technology mm-hmm. part of what we do, because it is actually in some areas rocket science. So a lot of that attracts and hopefully is motivating for the young generation. Virtual reality on our platforms, our new platforms, when we design them, we can actually walk around them in virtual reality. 4D seismic imaging, drone that we fly around and use for inspections, etc. Reservoir technologies that we are driving, and we are actually all the time leaning out and going the next step, the next boundary, seeing how we can push the industry and push our capabilities within what's safe to do. And I think we can do much more, so I would agree with the panel in telling that story. Mm-hmm. That is very attractive.
So can you just give us some insights as to what the situation is in Maersk now when it comes to need of workforce? Are you in need of engineers and specialists even after the crisis for the last couple of years?
Yes, we have, over the last 50 years, I think it's evident, built a very, very skilled and highly specialized workforce. And it is absolutely crucial that we maintain that also going forward. We heard during the sessions this morning the importance still of our industry, both in the transition from the ministers and certainly also in fulfilling the global demand. So I think there's a very strong purpose in terms of how we come across and that we are part of supplying the world with energy responsibly. So I do see a strong purpose for what we do in the industry.
And do you need specialists?
Yes, certainly we do. We need specialists. We need great engineers, geologists, skilled workforce, electricians, welders, etc. for the projects. Tire Futures is, I guess, a very tangible one that we're working to mature end this year. And that's, of course, going to be a massive investment in Denmark. And there we need highly skilled workforce for the hookup works that we need to do. Even running an installation, for instance, on Tyra, when we get into the next decades of life, just for that asset, the operating costs are around 500 million kroner per annum. Mm. And that goes straight into majority Danish jobs, Danish companies. So we're talking thousands of jobs just by that development for the future. And we need that. And that is highly skilled workforce.
And so you also mentioned trainees and the Danish Metal Workers Union said, well, you know, we've listened to this for a lot of years and you say we can't do it because it takes up space on the platform. There's a security issue. And they say, okay, guys, you just have to figure it out because it gives you a problem in the long run. So what can be done about that?
So I will broaden it slightly and say, in general, how do we attract and train graduates, et cetera? And in some areas, we have actually been quite successful. I do appreciate that the offshore does pose a challenge for safety reasons, training reasons, and bed space reasons. It is 200 kilometers away, and it is like a small town. So we do recognize there is a challenge. And also that oil and gas, as Martin Nesbø said, is also trying to help and facilitate how we can overcome that. That said, I would say for graduates in general, we have, for Maersk Oil, we run an international graduate program that we continued through the downturn. Even when we had to go through layoff, we still had an intake of graduates, international graduates. So we had more than 400 people through the international program of a two-year rotation and getting the opportunity to work not only in Denmark on international assignments and different jobs. And I think that's what we hear is very attractive, for certainly for the graduates. And I very much, if I can bridge that back to the discussion in the panel, I very much agree that we can also and should probably talk more about the opportunities it gives on your CV if you join our industry and you can change trades, both I think in the suppliers, very much actually between oil and gas and wind, and certainly coming in, taking project management experience, construction experience, etc. There's a lot of transferable skills also for engineers in doing that.
Okay, I think maybe we should take some questions on from the floor on this topic. Would you like to push your comment again? Yeah.
No, I'll pick it up where the discussion left, and then I'll leave it to Martin afterwards. I wanted to say I really appreciated what was said from ABB down there, from Norway, that I think if the same discussion was happening in Norway, we wouldn't have unions kind of saying this is a non-sexy business. They would say that's the most sexy business you could be in. Mm-hmm. Because that's the perception of the society. We heard from the minister, we all have an obligation to put this positively into our daily way of speaking about it. And that goes for union, that goes for the press as well. This headline of the last oil that's poison for the business. And we have just been talking about there's still we're only halfway on that. I don't think we will have the position in wind that Denmark has today without oil and gas. So we all have an obligation, and then back to you, Martin. And that goes for the operators as well. And I think I'm not offending you by saying that Maersk Oil over years has been pretty quiet in the public opinion about, and they've been pretty quiet about oil and gas. So what would you also see in the light of Total in the future do different and do better from a kind of a public opinion affair?
Thanks.
Very good question. I agree with your first comments. let me start with Total. I can't comment. We're still competitors until close, so I can't comment on Total. what I can say as an industry, and I'm sure that also comes with Total, yes, we have. I don't think we've been quiet in recent years. We've actually talked quite a lot about our industry, and especially around the North Sea negotiations and the potential, along with Oil and Gas. Denmark has done, I think, a great job at talking about the potential and the future potential that we do have. And we can continue doing that. I would like to see, and which we are trying to do, more on the technical angle, again, making it more sexy, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And then I couldn't help noticing that some of our young people joining in the discussion is also when we talk about diversity. I think we can be much better as an industry also thinking about diversity, both gender diversity and nationality diversity. And we have certainly seen, maybe we should do a bit of an exercise here. How many of you are working in a team with more than 25% females? Okay.
All right. Okay. That is
quite encouraging, etc. And not only gender, I think also in terms of nationalities, because we do know that diverse teams are higher performing in general. And I think that can actually also help potentially attract people that we right now as an industry don't attract to the degree where we could. So I think we need to look at all opportunities we have actually to ensure that we have the right influx into our industry.
Right. Okay. We have a question here in the front.
Yeah, it might just be more on reflection side, and I really appreciate, Martin, that you mentioned about the fact that young people come in and actually get to the grasp of big projects and so on. I just want to reflect very shortly on the fact that in Dong Energy, we are seeing a flux of young people going between the wind division and the oil and gas division. And what I find quite interesting, and this comes to part of the story that we need to tell and be better at telling, is If we have a young person staying 4 or 5 years in the oil and gas sector and they go to the wind side, very often we hear from the wind people saying, thank you so much, because actually you are contributing a lot to the development of the wind sector. It goes for project management that Martin was talking about. It goes about safety management. It goes about logistics, how you run that, and several other disciplines. So I think the changing these sectors and for young people to see that we can actually up the game and we can increase the capabilities that then can be transferred to the green sector, that story we need to tell much better. Mm-hmm. And we have many very concrete examples, at least in the Dong system, on that.
Okay. Very encouraging.
Can I make just one comment? And that was actually a question by John a bit mentioned before, and it was also in the panel, that we've been through this downturn, etc. That might scare a few people away. And it is hard going through a downturn. But again, what we can do is ensure that we're competitive for the stability. That's the best thing we can do to attract investments here in our sector. Being competitive as companies, as vendors, etc. In there. And I think that's the part. And to do that, we need to drive innovation. We need to think differently. We need to collaborate. And we need to have the sharpest brains that we can attract from all trades in Denmark. So there's a vested interest that we can do better in that area.
Thank you very much, Martin Rune Pedersen, for joining us here on stage.